Professor Stephen David Krasner and dear participants, very good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. Welcome to today's nice webinar on state building and democracy. We are really honored to have Professor Stephen Krasner to talk on a very important topic of today. The topic is really important for the region, as almost all the countries of South Asia are struggling to sustain democracy. We do not have very good news coming from Myanmar this morning. I, on behalf of NICE and the participants, would like to welcome Professor Krasner. Professor Krasner, let me briefly introduce you about our institute. Nepal Institute for International Cooperation and Engagement is an independent, apolitical, and non-partisan think tank which believes in freedom, democracy, and world free from conflict. We envision a world where sources of insecurity are identified and understood, conflicts are prevented or resolved, and peace is advocated. Professor Krasner did no introduction to our participants. Still, as the tradition, let me briefly introduce Professor Krasner. Professor David Krasner is a Graham H. Stuart Professor of International Relations at Stanford and a Senior Fellow at the Freeman Spogli Institute, the Hoover Institution, and at SIEPR. From February 2005 to April 2007, he was Director of the Policy Planning Staff at the Department of State. In 2002, he served as Director for Governance and Development at the National Security Council. He is the member of the Board of Directors of the United States Institute of Peace and was member of the Foreign Policy Advisory Board for the Department of State from 2012 to 2014. He received his BA from Cornell in 1963, Master's from Columbia in 1967, and PhD from Harvard in 1972. Before coming to Stanford in 1981, he taught at Harvard and UCLA. He was the chair of the Political Science Department from 1984 till 1991. Senior Associate Dean for the Social Science from 2010 to 2013, and Deputy Director of the Freeman Spogli Institute from 2007 to 2013. He edited International Organization from 1986 to 1992. His writing have dealt primarily with the political determinants of international economic relations, American foreign policy, and sovereignty. He is currently investigating the impact of external actors on domestic authority structure in weak state. He was a fellow at the Center of Advanced Studies in the Behavioral Science in 1987 to 1988, and at the Wissen Schaft School zu Berlin from 2000 to 2001. He has been a Marcator Fellow at the Free University Berlin from 2014. Professor Krasner is a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Science and a member of the Council on Foreign Relations. Professor Krasner, you will have around 30 to 35 minutes to make your remark, which will be followed by question and answers. This program is streaming live on several Facebook pages. Therefore, we request all our participants to drop their questions on the Facebook Live or share it on Zoom chat. You can also send your questions by Twitter or WhatsApp number that is being displayed on our screen. Professor Krasner, the floor is yours. Over to you, sir.
Hey, thank you. Thank you very much for having me. I realized when I accepted this invitation, I was very flattered that you'd ask me. It also made me realize how American-centric this is. So let me see if my screen share works, and I'll go through this in half an hour. Hopefully we'll have lots of time for questions. Okay, so the screen share is working.
Yes, sir.
All right, so thank you. So I published this book in last year called How to Make Love to a Despot. And I realized when I was thinking back on my career that the question of how countries get to be wealthy and democratic is something that I've been concerned with in one form or another for most of my career. I was actually in the Peace Corps in Nigeria in the early 1960s. You know, ending my career at Stanford, which is a very privileged place to be. And the conclusion that I come to is a simple and straightforward conclusion, which is that being wealthy and democratic is actually extremely hard. And sustaining it is very hard. And I think, you know, the experience of the United States over the last 4 years under the Trump administration is an example of how hard it is. So if you sort of step back and look at the 100,000 years, 200,000 years that human beings have been on this earth, there's been a huge amount of change in the last couple of years. So you know, if you look at, go back to 1800, most people were living on farms. Nobody had any idea what commuting was like. Basically people labored, there was no idea of coming to an office. I mean, if I look at most of my career, and I have to say, I didn't say see these things coming. You got up, you commuted to work, you went to an office, you taught your class, it was pretty clear what you would do. Now we find we're in the middle of this pandemic. Many things have obviously changed. So sitting where I live in Silicon Valley or in the United States, and what you see is that the political economy has dramatically shifted. So if you look at many people in the United States, you know, they worked hard. They did what they were supposed to do, and I haven't seen their life gotten any better over the last 30 or 40 years. For the class, I teach an introductory class in international politics, and I actually looked at the cost of housing in, say, the middle of the United States versus Silicon Valley, and you know, the same house costs $2.5 million in Silicon Valley and costs $500,000, which is not nothing, but in the middle of Iowa or Indiana. So I think what we should say is that things, you know, if we sort of look at human history and think about what's happened over the last 200 years, it's really been a very, very dramatic change. And even if you look at the response to COVID-19 and this pandemic, you know, for it's, yeah, it's true that it's spread around the world. It's also true that, you know, immunizations and inoculations have developed relatively quickly. So it's very different than things would have been in, or say, 300 or 400 years ago. So I think if you look at this issue of democratic development and wealth, there are only a small number of countries that have achieved democracy and high levels of wealth in a few areas of the world for a relatively short period of time. So if you look at most of human history, I mean, most of human history was much more problematic. I mean, if you look, a simple indicator would be life expectancy. If you went back 100 years, I mean, or 120 years, and life expectancy was maybe 40 or 50 years. In most places around the world, it's increased by 30 years. That's really an enormous change. In most places in the world, if you went back 100 years, most of your children died. Now it's kind of a tragedy. So I do know two people that died in their 50s. I don't know, well, I guess I know a couple of people that died early on in their teenagers or 20s, but that was quite unusual if you're looking at most of human history. So I think if you look at the OECD world, this world of wealthy democratic states, I mean, what we can say with confidence is very few countries have achieved consolidated democracy. Very few countries have achieved consolidated democracy with high levels of wealth. For most of human history, I mean, political systems have been exclusive, only a few people had access to them. Most political leaders were rent-seeking. They exploited other people. People were subject to exploitation. They were subject to violence. And now we think of violence as something that's relatively shocking, but it was sort of the way in which most of the world operated for most of the time that human beings have been on life. And I recently read, within the last few months, I mean, a very interesting book by an Israeli philosopher named Hariri, which says, if you look at human beings, why did human beings do well? Why do they end up dominating the earth? And basically, Hariri's argument is that human beings did well, not because they were stronger, not because they were smarter, not because they were bigger, but because they were able to organize themselves effectively into large groups, which other animals, including other kind of sapien-like forms like the Neanderthals, were not able to do as well. So this next chart that I have, which shows per capita income by region from 1820 until the beginning of the 20th century, you can see that, you know, for most places, they've been relatively flat. I mean, if I went back sort of 50 or 60 years to when I first went to Nigeria in the early 1960s, I think the expectation of most Americans, most Africans would have been that, you know, once you got rid of colonialism, you'd have wealth, you'd have democracy, and you'd have prosperity. In fact, that has not been the case. And there's been only one large country that's really become wealthy and democratic over the last, since the end of the Second World War, over the last 75 years or so, and that is South Korea. You know, so it's not as if that, it's not as if the world is marching towards democracy and marching towards high levels of wealth. So some parts of the world, as you can see on the black line, Western countries, countries of Western Europe and Western Russia have done very well. In most parts of the world, countries have not done as well. So I think if you look at, you know, this question of how did some countries become wealthy and democratic, that is the big question in social sciences. I think we really have, and I think this is a fair summary of the literature, at least as it has existed in the West. I think there are three candidate approaches. There's modernization theory, there are theories about institutional capacity, and there are theories about, which are very recent, about elite competition and bargaining, rational choice, the last one, I mean, another word for it is rational choice institutionalism. So let me go over each of these three theories, tell you which I think that the third is most persuasive, but that's obviously something which we can argue about and discuss. So if you look at modernization theory, begins in the 19th century. And it's clear you have in the 19th century, the Industrial Revolution in some relatively small parts of the world. And Marx and Weber are two of the people that were leading thinkers there. And they, and one thing you can say for these people is they realized they were living in a world where things were rapidly changing. So you had industrialization. I mean, Marx lived in London for much of his life. I mean, Weber lived in Germany for his whole life, I think. They recognized that things were changing pretty fast. And the basic story of modernization theory is that you see this happy couple, if you could just find your way to the bottom of the up escalator, you will keep going up. So all good things go together. And if you could just find your way to the bottom rung, things will be fine. All good things eventually go together. Basically, the escalator keeps going up and up. And this theory of modernization theory has really been, and basically what it says is that if you have population growth and you have technological change, you'll get economic growth. If you get economic growth, you get a larger middle class. If you get a larger middle class, you have the foundation for democracy. So it's really pretty straightforward. If you look at the empirical data about modernization theory, it is an issue that's been very highly studied by, at least by social scientists in the United States and around the world. And a lot of the evidence supports modernization theory, but not all of it. So, you know, on the positive side, there is an overall positive relationship between income levels and democracy. The wealthier you are, the more likely you are to be democratic. It's also true, and there have been a lot of studies around the world that if you look at the middle class, people in the middle class have attitudes which are likely to support democracy. They're more interested in rule of law. They have cross-cutting cleavages. They're willing to think rationally about what's going on around them. So, and they've done these studies in not just in the US and Western Europe, but also in Africa, Asia, and other places. So, you know, I think there is a lot of support which would say that modernization theory is basically what you should be looking at. I think the fundamental problem is the following. First of all, a technology is readily available in around the world, but not everyone has gotten wealthy. So technology is readily available. Not everyone has been able to take easy advantage of it. If you look at the empirical studies, first of all, while there's a very strong relationship between the level of economic development and the length of time that a country is democratic, so if you switch into democracy when you're pretty well off, you're likely to stay a democracy. If you become a democracy in your poor country, you're likely to revert to some kind of autocratic rule. But it's also the case that the relationship between wealth and democracy holds up very well up to about $10,000 per capita. But above $10,000 per capita, it gets much weaker. The relationship gets weaker. And also, if you look at, so countries are always shifting back and forth between autocratic rule and democratic rules. And that happens very frequently. And there isn't a strong relationship between levels of wealth on the one hand and transition to democracy on the other. So I think if you went back in the United States 4 or 5 years ago, basically the standard view would have been, look, China will become wealthier. Well, how make China wealth? It's very much based on modernization theory. As China becomes wealthier, it will have a larger middle class, and as a larger middle class will be more democratic. All right, if it's more democratic, it'll be more like us, that is more like the United States, and everything will be great. You know, I think of the United States now, and this is not just true of Republican administration, but I think also of the new Biden administration, people are much more skeptical of China. You know, lo and behold, China did become wealthier. The Chinese remained Chinese. They didn't become American suddenly. And I think this was kind of, and I think there's really a consensus now that China has become wealthier. It does have a larger middle class. It does not necessarily mean that China will become like the United States. So I think if you look at the empirical data and you think about modernization theory, it very much informed American policy, say from Nixon through Obama, American policy towards China. It doesn't, it no longer defines American policy, whether you think about the Trump administration or the Biden administration. All right, so I think modernization theory is the first major theory that we have, which looks at, you know, how countries become wealthy and democratic. And I think while there is a lot of empirical data which supports it, there's certainly some empirical data which does not support it. All right, what about the second approach to democracy and development, which I've labeled here institutional capacity? Certainly, you know, basically what this theory says is that unless you have a stable government and a stable regime, you're not going to get economic development. So the first thing you have to do is have a stable political regime. And certainly this begins with Hobbes. I mean, for those of you that are familiar with Hobbes, so Hobbes is writing right at the end of the English Civil Wars. You know, tens of thousands of people have been killed. They were essentially religious wars. The king, Charles II, had his head chopped off. Cromwell, first the father, and then the son, became the Lord Protectors of England. So it was a very chaotic period. And religious wars in Europe between, they were Christians, but these were variants of Christianity, between Catholics on the one hand and Protestants on the other, led to major wars in England and in France, and then the 30 Years' War, which was partly a religious war and partly a kind of realpolitik war, but certainly religion made the war bloodier than it would otherwise have been. And basically, if you look at the modern period, the person I think that we most associate with these arguments about institutional capacity are Huntington, and Huntington, who was a professor at Harvard for many years, I basically said, social mobilization, which is what you wanted if you have modernization theory, without political institutionalization leads to political decay. That was Huntington's basic equation. So if you think about institutional capacity, the escalator could go up, but it could also go down. So you might have a stable regime. It doesn't necessarily mean that you'd have a democratic regime. It doesn't necessarily mean that you'd have sustained economic growth. So if you, the big question for institutional capacity then is, where does institutional capacity actually come from? And here, I think if you're looking at the arguments which people made, I mean, there's no consensus in the literature about how you get institutional capacity. So the argument I think that's most familiar to scholars is war makes the state and the state makes war. This image that I have here is actually, it's the first image we have of a human being, and it's a king in Egypt, and you can see he's clubbing people, he's clubbing his opposition to death. So that at least this argument, so the classic argument here, it's an argument about Prussia and later Germany. it's sitting in the middle of Europe. It doesn't have, you know, in terms of it being invaded, it could be invaded from the east, from Russia originally, and then the small states were rather on the east, and then from the west, it could be invaded by France. It wasn't a very, if you wanted to survive, you had to be strong. So the argument is that if you look at Prussia, and if Prussia had failed to develop a strong and robust state, it would have been basically overthrown by its neighboring countries, as actually happened to some places like Poland, which disappeared totally from the map of Europe until in the 1790s until the end of the Napoleonic Wars. So, or until the beginning of the end of World War I. So war makes state and state makes war is one argument about where institutional capacity might come from. There are a number of other arguments. So one is an argument about social coalitions. And basically it says, countries get wealthy, they get a larger middle class. The middle class demands that the government become more efficient. So the government has to build roads, it has to build roads, it has to build schools. And this is an argument which you certainly see applied to early modern Europe. You know, in the contemporary world, it's Somaliland, which is kind of a breakoff region of Somalia, to the United States after the Civil War, in which the argument is, I mean, the state was very corrupt. Everybody knew that, but there was a lot of demands and a lot of pressure for the state to be more effective, to at least provide some things that wealthy people in the state wanted. So social coalitions, especially the ones that are from the middle class, is the second explanation for how you might get state capacity. A third explanation is an explanation about colonialism. So one of the arguments about Korea, which the Koreans don't particularly like, is that Japan actually was an instrument for bringing modernity to the Korea, also to Taiwan. They brought industrialization, they brought land reform, they brought a modern bureaucracy. So the fact that Korea was essentially a Japanese colony from 1895 until 1945 is something that ended up being very advantageous for Korea. So there's an argument about colonialism, but there are a number of other arguments, like, you know, there's an argument about British civil law providing better protection for private property, and therefore it's better to be colonized by the British than it was to be colonized by the French. And finally, there are a set of arguments about religion, which basically, you know, because it is sort of a mystery. I mean, why would people, you know, why do you have the state acting effectively? And the argument here is that religion, especially Protestant religions in Europe, were very advantageous for rulers because Protestants believe that they are saved by grace, not by good works. You see this very clearly in Max Weber, the Protestant ethic and spirit of capitalism. You know, the question is, why would people work hard? And Weber's argument was, people worked hard because they thought that worldly success was an indication from God, that you had been chosen. There's nothing you could do about it, so you know, which is a very anxiety-provoking kind of thing. But if God had shined his light on you, you would be successful. And if you were successful, that was an extremely good thing. And Weber argues that people tried to be successful because it was a way, it was an indication that it had been chosen by God. There's a sociologist at Yale University who argues that if you look at the Prussian bureaucracy in the 17th, 18th, and 19th century, a lot of people in the Prussian bureaucracy were Calvinists. Calvinists believe that you should act honorably, that if you'd hired by the state, you should serve the state, that was part of their religious belief as well as part of their civic belief, and that was critically important. So, you know, at least religion is the third explanation for where you might get state capacity. And finally, there is an argument about state capacity coming from exceptional leaders. So I know the one image that I think is very, very familiar is Lincoln, who's a leader in the United States. In the upper left, there's, it's an Ulaanbaatar. It's actually a statue of Genghis Khan. looks very much as if it's modeled on Lincoln. The guy on the lower left is Nuhu Rubato, who is a kind of reformer in Nigeria, who has run for government, run for the president in the last decade or so, and not been very successful. And the head of Rwanda, Paul Kagame. I mean, these are people that have, you know, where if you look at individuals, they seem to have made very good choices, but they don't provide any kind of systematic argument. So in any event, this argument about state capacity is a second argument that has been used to explain how states get to be wealthy and how they get to be democratic. All right, a third argument is, I mean, I think the first argument, modernization theory, I think if you scratch the surface of most policymakers, they would make that kind of argument. The second argument about institutional capacity is something they're relatively familiar with. The third argument is really an argument that's been developed in the United States, mainly by economists over the last 10 or 20 years. And it's really what I call the irrational choice institutionalism, but it has to do with elite bargaining and competition. So what this says is that if you want to be wealthy and you want to be democratic, elites have to make that kind of choice. And elites are driven by their own self-interest. They have different interests, and so they're not necessarily the same. They think strategically, and they have to be willing to expand the benefits. Elites have to be willing to expand the benefits which they themselves have been experiencing to the broader public, not necessarily to everybody originally, but at least to some people. And if you look at this rational choice institutionalism, you know, very much focused on elite bargaining you don't get a kind of systematic argument as you get in modernization theory about how you get to be wealthy and democratic. There are a lot of random events. There are a lot of haphazard events. And there's no teleology. There's no guarantee that you're going to move from being poor to being wealthy or from being autocratic to being democratic. There's no guarantee at all in this theory. So if you look at Britain, which is generally regarded as the founding state in terms of democracy, I mean, the argument in this is very much about how states developed. There was a lot of luck involved. So if you look at Britain, say the Magna Carta, which is regarded as, you know, it's kind of the beginning of democracy, but it's something that happened in the 13th century, and it happened, it didn't last very long, and it happened only because the king was relatively weak at a particular moment. So there's a deal between the king and the barons in England. Look at the Black Death in Europe in the 13th and 14th century. It killed 20, 30, or 40% of the population. One thing that clearly happened as a result of the Black Death is that many people died, rich people as well as poor people, made labor much scarcer. If you have scarce labor, what happens? So one thing is it gives labor more of a bargain, gives labor a stronger bargaining power. And the argument is that if you look at Western Europe, especially England and France, and what it led to is a kind of independent peasantry. If you look at Eastern Europe, I mean, another response that you could have to labor being, you know, these were basically agrarian countries. You needed a lot of labor. I mean, another response to the Black Death was that labor became scarcer and repression became stronger. So that, you know, there were relatively small differences between the peasantry in Eastern Europe and the peasantry in Western Europe. And the argument here is that the peasantry in Western Europe did well as a result of the Black Death, and the peasantry in Eastern Europe did relatively badly. The peasantry in Western Europe was able to become more autonomous. They were able to take advantage of the Black Death. The peasantry in Eastern Europe, and what happened as a result of the Black Death is that labor became more valuable and the aristocracy became more repressive. So if you think about England as being kind of the wellspring of democracy, you know, if you look at various kind of naval battles that Britain has had over the years, so there was, the Spanish Armada was defeated in the 16th century. Spain was the strongest country in Europe. It was Catholic. England was ruled by Elizabeth I. She was a Protestant. The Spanish Armada was a large fleet. Why was it created? Not to directly invade England, but to escort Spanish troops across the British Channel. So Spain controlled the Low Countries, controlled Belgium, controlled the Netherlands, controlled Spain. And it was that the weather was actually very much favored the English. The Spanish fleet was, the Spanish Armada was blown north. These were seafaring ships. They didn't have any steam power at that time. So the Spanish Armada was then able to escort these troops into England. I mean, England, if you look at England in the 16th century, it was disorganized. About half the people, half the population was Protestant, half the population was Catholic. A lot of people were very unhappy with Elizabeth I. You know, if the Spanish had succeeded in invading England, there's a good chance they would have won, and the history of the world would have been very different. If you look at the Glorious Revolution in 1688 in England, it's kind of this deal between the Parliament on the one hand and the King on the other. In which, and one thing that happened, you could get your head cut off if you were the king. So it was a dangerous position to be in. On the other hand, what happened with the Cromwells, if you look at the period after the English Civil War, where Oliver Cromwell and then Richard Cromwell, his son, became the Lord Protector of England, there was a lot of disorder, a lot of conflict during that period. So Parliament sort of, so when the Stuarts were first brought back in 1660, it wasn't because Parliament had been defeated, it was because they didn't know what to do except to have somebody who was actually a strong king. So I think if you look at what happened in England in 1688, basically what happened is the king thought, boy, I can stand against Parliament, but I could get my head cut off. And Parliament thought, well, I can stand against the king, but I don't know how to create a stable government. So you have this sort of compromise in which powerful people in England expanded kind of the rule of law, expanded the right to buy shares in corporations, but it wasn't something that happened because people thought, wow, we should make this country more democratic. I think it was something that happened because people were very much recognized that they wouldn't be able to act on their own. They had to find some kind of compromise. So I think if you look at how there was this long war basically between England and France, which really lasts from 1700 till the end of the Napoleonic Wars, 1815 or so. If you looked at the beginning, England was smaller, it was poorer, France was a bigger country, it could have a bigger army, it had more wealth, and it actually was in the long run defeated. And one argument, which is at least among social scientists, one argument that's very popular is, so what happened in England was you had the development of a set of institutions which constrained the ability of the king to borrow money. And because the ability of the king to borrow money was constrained, people who had wealth in the country, mainly merchants, were willing to loan money at lower interest rates. As a result of loaning money at lower interest rates, England was able to borrow more money than France, was able to create a bigger navy and ultimately a more effective army, and ultimately defeated France. So if you look at England in the 18th century, so the cannonballs were produced by private companies. The forts were built by private companies. The ships were built by private companies. So, and why did they do that? Because they were afraid that you could sort of see this very much in the United States now. If the king is able to effectively control the entire government, you would be really worried and really nervous. So, if the king was able to control your armed forces, that's something that would make you worry a lot. So, if you look at the United States, the president was able to by himself command the armed forces in the United States, which I think is actually quite hard to do, that is something that makes people very nervous. So I don't know how many of you have seen a movie that came out in 2019 or 2020 called Dunkirk. So the British were defeated by the Germans at the beginning of the Second World War. The British amassed their troops, the British Expeditionary Force, about 33,000 troops at Dunkirk, which was on the other side, in the Netherlands, and they were evacuated. And they were evacuated very successfully. And to carry out this evacuation, which was mostly British, but also some French troops, the British basically used every ship that they had available. And, you know, to have all these small ships evacuate all these guys from the coast of Holland, you know, the weather had to be pretty good. So if the weather had been stormy, if there hadn't been strong ships, if the Germans had wiped out the British Expeditionary Force and what was left of the French forces at the beginning of the Second World War, you know, I'm not saying that the war would have come out differently, but it clearly would have been very different than the war that was actually fought at the end of the Second World War. So I think basically, I mean, if you want a clear contrast, so if you look at institutional capacity, it says you need strong institutions. And without strong institutions, you will not have stability. And if you don't have stability, you won't have economic growth. If you look at rational choice institutionalism, what it says is that institutions have to be, and this is something that Adam Madison actually argued in the 18th century in the Federalist Papers. He says the government has to be constrained, but it also has to be effective. And that is really a hard thing to accomplish. How do you get a government that actually works well? So, you know, since political leaders don't want to lose their term in office, and being in office gives you money, it gives you prestige, it gives you all kinds of things that you like, that people like to have. You know, how is that going to work? And the argument of rational choice institutionalism is it can only work if you have some kind of separation of powers. And if you don't have a separation of power, you're because the institutions have to be effective, but they also have to be constrained. All right, stepping back for a second, if you look at each of these theories, none of these theories is perfect. So modernization theory, I think a big problem with modernization theory is why does growth occur in the first place? There have been a number of places historically where you had quite a bit of wealth, you had a large middle class, you didn't necessarily get democracy. So you look at, you know, the Chinese Empire, if you're looking at technological prowess, I mean, China was clearly much ahead of Europe until the Industrial Revolution, until the 19th century. If you look at the Roman Empire, I mean, the Roman Empire was very impressive. They built new roads, the Colosseum in Rome. It was very impressive. You look at classical Greece, if those of you that have visited the Parthenon. So the Greeks, especially Athens, I mean, they had a democracy. They're relatively wealthy and they didn't sustain it over a long period of time. So modernization theory, I think you've had lots of situations in which historically, in which you had large empires with a lot of wealth, they haven't necessarily become democratic. Why have they not been democratic? I think the clearest reason why they have not been democratic is because once political leaders get power, they don't want to give it up. They'll do everything they can to keep it because it gives them lots of things that they want. It gives them power, it gives them money, it gives them prestige. And they're only going to give it up if they see it as being in their political interest of doing so. And that, you know, engineering a set of institutions where your political leadership, which is willing to give up its control, is something which is very difficult to do. So institutional capacity, I mean, the basic problem here, I think, is that, okay, it's true that you need stability to get economic growth. And if you have chaos, you end up with Somalia. So that's not a very good outcome. But why institutional, if you have a lot of institutional capacity and you can maintain order in a country, why don't the people with guns govern the country in their own interest? Why would they ever do anything which would be in the interests of some other group? So the classic argument about China, which was ruled by an emperor really for 1,000 years, more than 1,000 years, is that the Chinese at the beginning of the 15th century had ships that were much larger than the ships that the Europeans had. Chinese crews in these ships were probably 100 times bigger than the crews that the Europeans had. And so if they'd been left alone, China would have discovered Europe instead of Europe, quote unquote, discovering the East and discovering Asia. Why did that not happen? And the argument is that the Chinese Empire saw the fleet as being a threat to its rule. It was generating a lot of wealth. It was generating a lot of trade. It was clear to the emperor that a lot of this trade was taking place in areas that he didn't necessarily control. So the emperor commanded that the fleet be recalled. This was the Ming emperor at the time. And it was basically burned up. So the result was you got to the 19th century when, basically the European countries primarily, also Japan and the United States conquered China. I mean, it happened because of the Industrial Revolution, but it really is kind of a mystery that that would have happened. Why did countries that were relatively poor, relatively technologically undeveloped, do well in the 19th century, where if you look at most of human history, China had been much more successful than the West. So I think of the trouble with institutional capacity is, yes, it's true that you have to have stability if you want to have economic growth, but if you have stability, why won't the guys with guns or knives or spears, that control violence, why won't they do it in their own interest instead of doing it in the interest of the population as a whole? So if we look at the United States, I mean, it's pretty striking that, I live in Silicon Valley. So here you have all, tremendous amounts of wealth has been generated by Google and Facebook. They've operated at a global level. It's pretty striking that that could have happened. So is that wealth that's controlled by political leaders? Not necessarily. All right, so I think if you look at the problem with institutional capacity is, it's very clear they want to have a government that has the capacity to maintain order, because without having order, you want to have wealth. But it doesn't explain why you end up with a situation in which rulers, elites, would ever give up their power. If you look at rational institutionalism, so the problem here, I think, is that there is no systematic explanation for why countries make the leap from orders which are basically autocratic to orders which are democratic. And a second problem, and it's a major problem, is there's nothing in between this sort of world of exploitation on the one hand and a world of development on the other. So I think, I will stop here, but let me just say, I think there's something that comes out of this, which is that if you want to think about, this is, I realize, very American-centric, you've got to find a national elite that you can ally yourself with. The picture on the right-hand side is of MacArthur with Hirohito, the Emperor of Japan. Hirohito could have been tried by the Americans as a war criminal. It was not. MacArthur actually allied with them very quickly. The picture on the left-hand side is Bush and Maliki. Maliki was the Prime Minister of Iraq. So I do think, since I worked in the Bush administration, there was very much an expectation on the part of people in the Bush administration, people around him, that, if you invaded Iraq and you took the sewer off, the sewer cover, democracy would spring forth. That actually has proven to be very difficult to do. So I think the kind of lesson, and it's driven on by what's happened in the United States over the last several years, is that having democracy is hard. Having democracy and wealth is even harder. That the number of countries that have become democratic and wealthy, existed in North America, Western Europe, parts of Asia, but they're not very many. If you look at the OECD, I think the OECD now has about 30 member states, not all of which are, while they're all that democratic. It's really hard to do. And most countries in the world are still poor and still autocratic. And being poor and being autocratic is not an unnatural state of affairs, but if you look at most of human history, it's really very much a natural state of affairs. All right, let me stop there. And I know that we'll have some time for questions, and I'll actually see if I can stop screen sharing.
Thank you, Professor.
All right, if you have any questions, I'll try to answer them as best I can.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for a really enlightening presentation. It was really interesting and we learned a lot. We are really grateful for your valuable time. The question have started to flood. So without wasting time, let me move to the questions. The first question is, what you see around is that largest democratic states are turning conservative, where the democratic ethos are at stake. For instance, in India and the United States. How do you look at these developments?
Well, I think what I'm looking at the United States, which I'm more familiar with than I am with India. So you do have this very rapid change. This change has worked great for some people, but not so well for others. So if you look at the United States, life expectancy for poorly educated whites in the United States, so it's people without a college education, is actually declining. That's a really pretty amazing figure. Lots of people voted for Trump. All right, so I admit I'm living in a kind of bubble in Northern California where, if somebody voted for Trump, they probably wouldn't admit it out loud. But I think if you look at a lot of people in America, let's say you went back to say 1950 or 1960. So you got a high school education, you went to work for General Motors. Your father worked for General Motors. You actually lived a pretty decent life. Your wife didn't have to work. You earned a pretty good salary. There was a story in the New York Times about someone who worked in a General Motors plant in Ohio. So he worked in the paint shop, and first there had been 21 people, then there were 8 people. What happened then was a lot of the people that had been workers had been replaced by robots. And then General Motors closed down this plant entirely and opened the plant in Mexico because labor was less expensive. So I think what happens, if you think about democracy, look, maybe I'm wrong, but I don't think people have some sort of abstract desire for democracy. I think democracy is great because it creates a political environment in which you can achieve, your economic self-interest or other kinds of interests that people might have. But it's not an abstract desire for democracy per se. And if you find that the democracy is not performing well for you, I don't think you can rely on some sort of, ethical adherence to democratic principles. It's great if it works well for you. For someone like me, it's great. For someone in Ohio, at least has a high school education, worked for General Motors and then lost a job at 50, it's not so great. So I think if you look at India or you look at the United States, and what's happening around the world is you're having very rapid change. So it may be correct that if in India, so I don't want to claim to be any kind of expertise. So maybe if you change rules on agriculture, you'd end up with a higher level of food security in India as a whole. It doesn't mean that when you're making this change, that it's going to work great for the people that are farmers now. So, I think if you went back to 1800, probably 90% of the people in the United States are farmers now, it's less than 5%. Those are big changes. If you look in this area that I'm living in, and we can sort of see this breaking on us right now. So here we've had, a COVID epidemic. We have Zoom meetings, so nothing's meeting in person. So we have Zoom meetings. But one thing that's happened is people have stopped commuting. They're not commuting anymore. They're having Zoom calls. So, I think I was sort of lucky to have lived in a very wealthy period and a very stable period. It doesn't mean that my kids or my grandkids are going to live in a similar kind of stable period. So I think if you look in India or look at the United States, what I would say is that really, I've had amazingly rapid change, especially if you look at, say the period you should be paying attention to is 100,000 years, not 100 years. We had a very rapid change and, it benefited some people, it didn't benefit others. And I don't believe that people adhere to democracy as an abstraction. I think they adhere to democracy because they see that democracy is a good kind of political order to live under.
Thank you, Professor. Let me move to the next question. Is political crisis such as the recent incident at the Capitol Hill a time to really reorient and rejig institution and political process in the electoral democracies? Secondly, economies like South Korea, Taiwan, Singapore, and China have strong economies in command than politics. How do we access such transformation in authoritarian systems?
Yeah, so I think if you look at China, let me take China as an example. So it's true that if you look at South Korea, I mean, it was, you know, in the 1950s, per capita income in South Korea was very low. It was about the same as it is in most parts of Africa. So South Korea has been a very successful country, you know, but it's tough. I mean, if you look at most of the people that have been presidents in South Korea, they've been thrown out, they've been thrown in jail for corruption, they've committed suicide. You know, so it's making this transition, it's not necessarily an easy thing to do. And I think if you look at South Korea now, so one, you had this threat from North Korea, and two, you had a lot of support from the United States in terms of money and military support. So I think South Korea is really an exception. I mean, I think if you're looking at China, if I were the president of China, if I was Xi Jinping, which I'm obviously not, you know, I would look around and say, wow, we've done great, you know, because it's clear to me. I mean, many people in China have kind of escaped poverty, moved to cities, they're better off than they were in the past. Life expectancy in China now is as high as it is in the United States or higher. They've done terrific. Now, then you'd have this, why would Xi Jinping, you know, give up power that he has? Why would you expect a transition to take place in communist China? I mean, if I had to bet, I'd bet that there are contradictions in China, which the Chinese won't be able to deal with. But I don't expect the Chinese Communist Party to sort of wake up and say, oh, democracy is a great thing, let's adopt it. I mean, I think if you look at Xi Jinping, you know, China's been very successful. The party's been very successful. As my colleague Frank Fukuyama says, I mean, what they haven't learned to deal with is the bad emperor problem. I mean, it's great if you have a good emperor. It's great if you have someone who's sort of thinking rationally. Although you can see that China is it's a huge country geographically. It has 1.4 billion people. So it's not that easy if you're Xi Jinping and you're sitting in Beijing to understand what's happening in the provinces. So that in itself is a huge challenge. So I think the problem in China is that, you know, if you were like Xi Jinping, a leader of the Communist Party, you'd say, we've done great. You know, what are the pressures that would lead President Xi to give up power? Very difficult. You know, I think if you look at the United States, you look at Trump, you know, would Trump have hung on to power if he'd been able to? He could have. Why wasn't he? Because there were a lot of, you know, he ran into a lot of resistance in the courts, ran into a lot of resistance in the press. Now, I think, although I'm not sure, that he would have run into resistance from the armed forces, so that it was, you know, but it took a long time to sort of get to the place where you had this separation of powers, which you do have in the United States. You know, but it isn't because, you know, Donald Trump was some kind of aberration. I don't think it was an aberration. I think he enabled, you know, sentiments which a lot of people in the United States had. So basically, I mean, I think the problem with institutional capacity, if you think about China, is, you know, how will you get transition to the democratic regime? I think it's really a matter of luck and happenstance. You know, I mean, you know, what would have happened in England if they hadn't, you know, Charles II hadn't been such an idiot to get his head cut off? Could have been really different. You know, what would have happened if the Cromwells had been more effective rulers in, you know, and you hadn't had this chaotic situation in England in the 1650s. History could have been very different.
Thank you, sir. Let's move to next question. Without stability, you cannot have economic growth in democracy. While without economic growth, it is not easy to have stability. In this context, how can a stable democracy be sustained in weak state of Asia and Africa?
Yeah, so I think this is a really good question. I do think it's right that, you know, and here I think modernizationist theory is correct, that if, you know, having a large middle class is attractive because a large middle class, you know, wants to rule of law, not because I think the middle class is particularly virtuous, but because, you know, people work on, you don't want the state to just grab your money. So you want rule of law, because you see it as a protection for yourself. So I think you have to have, so prosperity is important. You know, it's important bedrock, but it's not automatic. And I think that it's really, you know, if you think about outside actors, can you still hear me, or? Did I lose my internet connection? Some of you may still hear me. So I think I'm still on, but you might have dropped off. You know, I think that if you're thinking about democracy, it's really a matter of luck. And it's very hard for external actors to find out effectively what's happening within countries.
Let's move to next question, sir. Is continuous decline of legislature and increasing judicial activism denoting increasing dictatorship?
I'm sorry, can you repeat the question for me?
Is continuous decline of legislature and increasing judicial activism denoting increasing dictatorship?
So I think it's, you know, I have to say, first of all, I don't know. Let me be honest and say that first. I think it's actually, if you look at the US, it's actually much more effective if you can take actions through legislators which are elected than if you take them through judiciary. And the problem with the judiciary is, you know, you have judges, they may be very skilled people and very highly educated, but they're so limited in number. And if courts make decisions which many people disagree with, you know, they'll be upset by that. Whereas I think that things are more easily accepted if they're actually legislated rather than enacted through the judiciary. Although, as I said, it's not something that I've studied. I'm not completely sure about that answer. But I think if you can do things through the legislature, that's better than doing it through the courts.
There's another interesting question. Does democracy really reach to the lowest strata of the society, or the strata is still waiting for it? A state is really working for it, or is there any problem with it?
Yeah, so I think it's also a very good question. So I think initially, you know, if you look at the 19th century, countries that we think of now as being democratic, democracy only reached with a small number a small part of the population. You know, a lot of the population was poor, they didn't have property, they didn't, you know, democracy didn't matter much. I think if you look at modern democracies, all right, look, I think that it's true that access to the legal system and other kinds of benefits of being in democracy mainly apply to people that have resources. But I do think that the fact that the government cannot act in arbitrary ways is something that really is effective for the population as a whole. So in the United States now, for instance, you know, the draft was abolished after the Vietnam War. The armed forces are relatively limited. You know, if my son or my grandson got a letter now which said you have to show up to serve in the army, you know, the reaction of America would be, you have no right to do that. So, you know, there are certain benefits which I think everybody enjoys in a democracy. You know, it's true that you know, if you're poor and you have limited resources, and you see this over and over again in the United States, people don't enjoy the same advantages that wealthy people have, but they do enjoy, I think, some advantages. I mean, the state may act in bad ways, but it wouldn't act as bad ways as it would act if you're in an autocratic regime.
Thank you. So there's another question on China. China is not a democracy, but it is evolving in a dynamic way with impressive growth rate and stability. how do you look at China from the prism of state building, which you have briefly addressed? Maybe you want to add.
Right. So I think if you look at China, there are really, you know, four different possibilities. So one possibility, and this would be very much modernization theory, China becomes wealthier, it becomes democratic. That's one possibility. China is a large state, it becomes wealthier, remains autocratic. We actually have no historical experience with that. No state has actually done that. So there are small states like Singapore, and they're very wealthy, but they're also pretty small. A third possibility is that, and you know, people have talked about the, you know, sort of China sort of stalls out, that basically China's become wealthy by having a surplus population that was moved from rural areas to urban areas, and by stealing technology from other places around the world, which is what I think the Soviet Union did. So it may sort of stall out. I mean, a fourth possibility, which is a real possibility, is that China breaks down into civil war. So there are very, if you look at China, I mean, the difference in per capita income between, say, Shanghai, you know, which looks like any other wealthy city around the world and rural areas is very substantial. And, you know, if I had to bet, if you forced me to bet, I should bet now, you know, I think China will actually stall out or might actually break down. I don't think you're going to get the Communist Party voluntarily giving up power. You know, could China be rich or autocratic? I think that's really very hard because I think, you know, the question is if you're Chinese, you're making investments, you're making a lot of money. You don't want a situation where the state can simply grab your money. I mean, that may work for a few people, it won't work for lots of people. So either you won't make the investments in the first place, or you'll have what you have, which is, you know, lots of wealthy Chinese buying real estate overseas because they think it's more secure. But, you know, in fact, if China does, you know, continue to become wealthier and wealthier and remains autocratic, that is something which we haven't experienced in the past.
So let me move to next question. Multicultural society is the biggest challenge for every state to accommodate. After the case of France, how a democratic state will solve the problem of religious freedom of citizens with religious extremism?
Yeah, so I think this is a very good question, and it's a really hard problem. So I think this is me. I mean, that, you know, it's sort of based on some of my research, but I'm not sure everyone would agree with this. So I think it is a huge mistake for the state to involve itself in religion. And why is it a big mistake? Because, look, people don't like dying. And religion is something that human beings have used to explain, you know, what happens to after death, so you don't have permanent death. So, I mean, I think if you look at the Peace of Westphalia, I mean, the Peace of Westphalia, which was a couple of treaties that were signed in 1648, are often regarded as the beginning of the modern period of sovereignty. I think they were much more about religious toleration. So what you had in Europe originally was, it wasn't that you had religious freedom. People couldn't do anything that they wanted, but you did have religious toleration. So one thing that happens in the Peace of Westphalia is it actually freezes religious practices as they existed in January of 1624. So the fact that a Protestant king became, you know, a Protestant became the ruler of some Catholic area didn't mean that the area suddenly became Protestant, remained Catholic, and it had the same rules that it had before. So I think I don't have a good answer on the extremism side. I think that's a relative, so I guess what I'd have to say if I were forced to say something, if you're looking at religious extremism, it's a relatively small population that, I think, you know, basically what democracies ought to do is allow people freedom of religion. And if they take away freedom of religion, it's a very dangerous thing to do because people are really so much embrace the religion that they have, most people. So, you know, but I think if you have a set of religious, you know, if religious extremism really dominates some religious practices, that is a really difficult issue for democratic states.
Thank you, sir. We are running out of time, so let me put the last two questions. Isn't the state building thesis largely a byproduct of capitalism-based market economy and therefore involve its follies too in the guise of the so-called modernization?
All right, so I think that it's not simply capitalism. I think all powerful states have done so. Even if you go back to classical Greece, you know, 400 BC, Sparta versus Athens, the Athenians were democratic. They wanted democratic states. So I think that powerful states try to create regimes in their own image. I don't think it's a problem of capitalism. I think the rationalizations might be different over time. So the United States has been very powerful for the last century or so. You know, it's true that the United States, you know, there is kind of an ethos of democracy and capitalism. You know, so Americans think that's the way the world should be ordered, that that's the best way to order the world. But I don't think this is something that's unique to capitalism. I think realpolitik is actually a better way of explaining the severed by one state to make another state in its own image. And what's happening now is also what happened in the 19th century, and even what happened more than 2,000 years ago.
Thank you. So the last question for today is political development devoid of any ideological commitment?
That's a good, so I would say yes, but I could be wrong. And I say yes for the following reasons. So I think the key to having economic development is that people feel that if they work hard, invest their capital, whatever they're doing, that the state's not gonna come along and grab it. You don't want the situation that you had in China in the 15th century where you have this, you're a very prosperous merchant, and the state could simply grab your stuff. So I think the key thing is not a commitment to democracy or a certain set of values, but a commitment to the fact that the state, even though it might be very powerful, and it is very powerful, it cannot arbitrarily take your resources. So I think if you want to have economic development, you have to have confidence on the part of the population that the state will not simply come in and grab their wealth.
Professor Krasner, thank you very much for the wonderful discussion. It was a privilege to have you with us. We learned a lot and we are really grateful for your time. I'm sure our audience also benefited from it. We still have lots of questions, but we have come to the end of the program. We are really, thank you so much. We hope to see you in some part of the world. And
thank you so much for having me. This is one of the pluses of Zoom. Thank you. Thanks for asking.
Thank you, sir. And we'd also like to thank all our participants for their presence and wonderful question. Professor Krasner, good night and good day to all our participants from Asia.